Hello, everyone. I hope everybody can hear me. Is it too loud? Okay, fine. Great that there are so many people in here. It's a great honor for me to speak on this stage. If you're wondering from where this strange accent comes from, I'm from the same country from which also Arnold Schwarzenegger comes from. I think you got the point. I will hold this talk in English because Eric Jenaar always complains about my Austrian German. So, one slide about me. I'm a father of two awesome boys, which are here on my laptop, by the way. And in my day-to-day job, I'm some kind of the DevOps guy. I care about a microservice stack which is run in Kubernetes and try to keep it running. I know being a DevOps guy has some smell, but yeah, that's another topic. Before I became the DevOps guy, I was coder for more than 10 years. Then I read Jess Humble's awesome book, Continuous Delivery, and I changed a lot of my views and also changed my focus. Besides my day-to-day job, I'm also do some freelancing, some consulting, and due to I still really love to code, I try to code in my freelance projects. And I'm also the organizer of the EAAM, which stands for Infrastructure as a Meetup. It's a small meetup in Linz, Austria, so if you want to visit Austria and you have a great talk, please contact me. By the way, this talk is not for experienced Prometheus users, it's more beginner's talk. So, yeah, some kind of field report, how we are using it in the company I'm currently working. And yes, some gotchas will be in there. This is basically us 7 months ago. We had a guy in the middle. We switched from monolith to microservices. We had some issues with our previous monitoring tool, which was Isinger. And then Prometheus came along. As already mentioned, we switched from monolith to microservices. And of course, we had an ops explosion, a lot of new things which we need to for communication between the microservices, for example. And Isinger simply didn't fit to our needs anymore because a lot of dynamic came in, and it was basically configuration hell. We also did Isinger. We had a lot of shell scripts which were not in a version control system, which also made things not really that easy. The company I'm working for is a very agile company, so we are changing a lot of stuff on a daily basis. And that's also hard to maintain in Isinger. The devs had the issue that they couldn't do monitoring of their business logic, but not that easy, let's say it like this. And the ops were also not that happy anymore because their dashboards got full with information they didn't care about. Maybe we should do a step backward and ask the question, do we need monitoring at all? Here you can see some kind of human body. The human body consists of toes, lung, heart, bones, skin, and so on. It's a very complicated system. And as far as I got nature, it only invests in stuff it really needs. So there's no luxury on our bodies. There are some exceptions. We do not know for what the appendix is for. We do not know it yet, as far as I know. But nature only invests in stuff it really needs. Half a minute ago, I forgot some crucial parts about the body. The body also has the nervous system. It also has the five senses, so eyes, ears, nose, tongue, and skin. And as it looks, nature invested heavily in monitoring. And if I kick against the desk, my toe hurts, I get an alert, and maybe I change my behavior. So maybe we should learn a little bit more from nature. I'm saying this because we also had our discussions to get the budgets for that stuff. How important this monitoring stack of our body is, you have to learn. If you lose one sense, if you get blind, if you get deaf, your life changes drastically. By the way, software systems are also complicated systems. Let's talk about Prometheus. The clicker doesn't work as I would like. It's open source. It's inspired by Borgman. The fairy tale goes like this. Two Google engineers went to SoundCloud, missed Borgman, which is the monitoring tool for Borg. Borg is some kind of the predecessor of Kubernetes. And these two guys implemented Prometheus in SoundCloud. And 2 years ago, they donated it to the CNCF. Yes. It's heavily, Prometheus is intended to be used for dynamic environments. If you're talking about the new stack, about microservices, about container orchestration, you should definitely take a look at Prometheus. It's pull-based, which means the Prometheus server scrapes the data from clients. In the Prometheus world, the clients are called exporters. This has advantages. The server can throttle the load if he is under pressure. And also the client libs, the clients, the exporters, have less work to do. A few weeks ago, I read a quote about when you master a tool, and it goes like this: when you know when not to use it. I have a visualization for you. Yes. So, let's talk about when not to use Prometheus. Prometheus was not made to be used for logging. Use something else. Use Splunk. Use Elk. It's not intended to be used for tracing. There's the Open Tracing Initiative, and you can use Jaeger for that. It's not a long-term archival system, which means if you want to store data for a time period of 2 years, it's maybe not intended to be used for that. In our company, we store data for about a month, and we are fine with that. It depends on your needs, basically. Prometheus has no cluster mode. If you already had the fun, or already have the fun, to keep a ZooKeeper cluster up and running, or Elk stack, or Rabbit, you know that's not that easy. If we are talking about high availability and doing updates. It was a design decision by Prometheus to not have a cluster mode. But there are some other things which can help here. You can use Federation. Federation allows you to build hierarchies of Prometheus servers. That is the bird's eye view of the Prometheus stack, basically. In the center, there's the Prometheus server. It deals with getting the data into it. In the end, the data gets stored on a disk, for sure. And there's the Prometheus query language, so afterwards you want to query stuff again, to build dashboards, to create alerts, for example. This section is about where do we get data from. As already mentioned, there is something which is called federation to build hierarchies of Prometheus servers, so you can scrape the data from another Prometheus server. Most of the time, you will scrape data from exporters. We will talk about four exporters today, the Node exporter, the C-Advisor, the Blackbox exporter, and the MySQLD exporter. And there's something which is called Bush Gateway. So if we are talking about batch jobs, most of the companies have some kind of batch jobs in their stack. Prometheus has an issue because it can't scrape the data all the time. A batch job normally doesn't live 24/7. So for this push gateway was invented. So your batch jobs push data to the push gateway, and afterwards the Prometheus server can pull again from the push gateway the data. Service discovery. If we are talking about container orchestration, Prometheus has a very convenient way to work with such beasts, basically. For example, console or Kubernetes, for sure. I will show this also, how this is done. Basically, you do not have to care if a node dies, if a new node gets created, if you scale up. Prometheus talks to the Kubernetes API, and you are not in configuration hell because Prometheus does this work for you. So this is the output section, yeah, and you can build visualizations. And you can create alerts with the Alert Manager, which is a separate application. So what is a metric? So, as already mentioned, there are these exporters where the Prometheus server scrapes the data from. And this in the black box is exactly what you will see in the HTTP endpoint of your exporter or of your application. Metric has a metric name. It has a collection of level values and level keys. And it has a value. This is a float 64 value. There are some advices on good metric names. So if you write your metric for your own application, for example, you should prefix it with the application name. If you're writing a library to be used by other applications, invent some kind of namespace. You should also use postfixes, and there are some base units, and Prometheus recommends to use exactly that words. So if we are dealing with time, use seconds. Do not use hours, do not use milliseconds, use seconds. If you're talking about temperature, use Celsius, length, meters, bits and bytes, bytes. If we are talking about percent, use ratio, and the value should be between 0 and 1. And I give you a few seconds to read this for metric names. I think you got the point. You get an idea what is this metric about by reading the name. Yeah. So what is a time series database? It's a software system that is optimized for handling time series on a data indexed by time. So the point here is indexed by time. So it's easy and very performant to write data in there with a timestamp and also to query that stuff afterwards. What is a time series? It's uniquely identified by a metric name and a set of key value pairs, also known as labels. The important point is metric name and set of key value pairs. A time series in the end will be a file on the disk. So each time series will be persisted as a file. And the point here is, if you have label values with a high cardinality, then you probably will become issues. The Prometheus guys recommend do not use, for example, email or user ID as label value, because you will get a lot of files in the end on disk. Scraping, the term scraping means getting the data into it. And on doing a simple scrape, you get the following data will be stored in your time series. So it's a millisecond precision based timestamp, Unix timestamp, and a float 64 value. On doing a single scrape, you get four metrics out of the box, and they are useful. For example, this one, the up metric, which says the host Apollo on port 9047 was available. 1 stands for available, 0 stands for not available. Exactly this metric you can use for building single page dashboards, which give you information about the system state. You can create tiles, and yeah, it's useful. And you have information about how long did scraping take, and you have information how many samples were scraped, and you have information how many samples did exist after relabeling was done. So let's talk about relabeling. Relabeling changes the value of a label, or adds a label, or deletes a label. This is rather a stupid example. There are some labels which you get out of the box, for example, job or instance. You can use them afterwards in your queries. There are some internal ones, like scheme or address, which start with 2 underscores or 3 underscores. These labels will be removed after the relabeling phase, so you will not you cannot use them in your queries afterwards. So there are 3 different types of relabeling configurations. Here you see a timeline. So first of all, we scrape data. Then you ingest data into the database, and afterwards you perhaps some alert can happen. So the first relabeling config is called relabel config. It happens before scraping. This sounds weird, but it's very useful. We will see that later in the black box exporter. You can change, for example, the address of the endpoint you want to scrape. Before ingestion, before data gets into the database, you can add labels, remove labels, or change labels with the metric relabel config. And the same is true for alerting. This is how the relabeling configuration looks like in the Prometheus configuration. And by the way, this is exactly what you mean, what you need to get all metrics about your nodes in your Kubernetes cluster. So that's all. You don't have to care if a node dies. If you spawn up new nodes, it's done for you. So the first relabel config is rather simple. We change the scheme to HTTP. The second one is a little bit more complex. We take the value of the address label, apply an regex on it, rewrite it in the address label, and change the port. Prometheus query language is a huge topic. I will not have the time to go in there in detail. I think we will simply do some examples. These are valid queries. So the first one says, give me all the data, basically for all requests. The second one says, give me all the data for the GET requests on the endpoint hello. You can apply regex too. So you can say, give me all the data which were sent to instances which have double B in the name. You can do OR relationships. Give me all the data for all GET or POST requests. You can switch back in time, so give me all the data which happened before five minutes. And there are a lot of functions. The sum function, for example, gives me a concrete value. So give me the sum of all requests. And you can do, for example, the rate of increase over the last 5 minutes. On having a Prometheus server in production, you will come into the situation to have to change the configuration. In Prometheus, configuration is done within a file. There is no UI to change the configuration. It's also a design decision by Prometheus to keep things simple. But now you have the issue, I want to change the configuration, but I do not want to stop Prometheus, because if I stop Prometheus, nobody will scrape data. To achieve, to come out of this misery, you have to enable this flag. If you started with Docker, you have to enable this flag. And afterwards, you can do the following. You can exec into the container and do a kill minus ckup one. One is the process ID. And the Prometheus server will reread the configuration file and will apply your changes. If you don't want to exec into the container, you can also do a post request to this URL, so slash minus slash reload. Again, Prometheus server will reload the configuration file and apply your changes. Let's talk about some exporters before we come to the coding part. The node exporter gives information about your machines, no matter if bare metal or VMs. You should start it like this, so no Docker involved here, because the node exporter needs access to the host system. You can do it via Docker, but it's not recommended. Yeah. And you get stuff like that. Give me, so this metric is about CPU usage. The next one is about memory usage. This one is about the some files, some mount, how many disk space you have. And this one is about network traffic. C-Advisor. C-Advisor builds on Docker stats, and if you have a Kubernetes stack, on each node slash minion, kubelet is run, and kubelet also provides the C-Advisor for you. So it's very easy to get these metrics in a Kubernetes stack. So you can run the C-Advisor via Docker container. You have to mount some volumes to get the information. And then, no. Sorry for that. I think a switch. Yeah. You get information about the network. You get information about the memory usage. Yeah, this sucks. Then there's the black box exporter. It gives you information about if you have a customer-facing page and you want to know if it's alive or not, you can use the black box exporter. And by the way, on doing this slide, I wanted to have this image with the Chrome Dino, and I found out you can play this game also with a working internet connection, which is awesome. You start black box exporter like this, no magic in here. There is complicated relabeling configuration, and we only look at this here, so we want to check if Google is available. The relabeling configuration changes the URL. As already mentioned, you have the different relabeling configurations, and this one changes the URL where the Prometheus server will scrape the data. It doesn't ask asks Google if it's alive. It will ask the black box exporter, which is running on localhost, and the URL Google will be sent as a URL parameter. Yeah, and then you get information like how long did DNS lookup time take? Yeah, information about how long does stuff take, what status code you got, and when your certificate will when the certificate will expire, which is very useful to have an alert for that. I'm speaking from experience. The MySQL exporter. You have to start it like this. There's one gotcha. It took me 2 hours for the two brackets. If you don't do the two brackets, this will not work. I do not know why the two brackets are needed. You have to grant access for the exporter to the MySQL you want to monitor. And afterwards, you get information like how many inserts did happen, how many selects did happen, how many data is in there in specific tables, and seconds behind master if you're doing replication. It's a very important information. And you will be very happy to have alerts if something goes wrong. Yeah, let's talk about coding. There are official client libraries for Go, Java, Python, and Ruby. There are also some unofficial ones. Yeah, a lot of. Let's talk about Java, Spring Boot, and Prometheus. In this case, the things I will tell set values. So you first you define the label value, and then you can increment if we are talking about a counter. This method is overwritten, so you can also increment by a concrete number. Yeah, this is basically how such a metric can look like. Gauche can also can go down. Yeah, nothing new here. Name, help, labels, registered. And afterwards, you can set some value. Yeah, nothing new here. So, not that interesting. Histogram can look like this. So this is a visualization of a histogram. So a histogram consists of buckets, and a bucket groups the values within its boundaries. So on using a histogram, you have to define the buckets up front. So here we are saying, I want to have a bucket for the values from 0 to 250. I want to have a bucket from 0 to 500. I want to have a bucket from 0 to 750. And then we observe values. The matrix in the HTTP endpoint can look like this. So this says me 9 values were below 250, or 28 observations were below 500, including the 9 from above, and so on. You have meter info. So there were 57 observations, and the sum of all observations is something with 29,000. Afterwards, you can calculate quantiles. So here I'm saying, with Prometheus query language, give me the 0.9 quantile of my histogram. So the last of the four metric types is summary. I will talk about the differences to the histogram in a minute. You define a summary like this. At this point in time, you already define the quantile. So we are saying, give me the median, give me the 0.9 quantile, give me the 0.99 quantile. Some of you will have noticed there's a second parameter. What's this about? Due to the quantile calculation is an approximation. This parameter gives the rate of tolerated error. Yeah, you observe values. And you get the following matrix. So basically, this is saying 50% of the values were below 475, 90% of the values were below 878, also including the upper lines. And meter information. So what's the difference between summary and histogram? Again, it's the point in time when things happen. If you're talking about a summary, the calculation of the quantiles will happen in your application. And if you're talking about the histogram, the calculation of the quantiles may happen in your Prometheus server. Depends if you do the query. So it depends on your use case. It depends on your needs. Where you want to implement, where you want to calculate the quantiles. You can also time methods. You have to add an annotation. For sure, it's Spring. It's all about annotations. Enable Prometheus timing. Afterwards, you can put this annotation on your methods, a name, help, and you get the following data, which is interesting. The method was called 21 times, and it took a little bit more than 1 second for all 21 method calls. There are some additional metrics you get for free from Spring framework. You have, again, enable annotation, enable Spring Boot metrics collector. Afterwards, you get this data. This is only XYAP, but you get information how many memory was free on the GVM, how long this application is up, how many threads are involved, how many for each and every endpoint in your application, you get also some information and how many, for example, 200 were delivered back. Micrometer. On doing my preparations for this talk, Spring Boot 2 came out, and for sure I wanted to try it. And everything was broken, but that's okay, it's a major release. And this has to do with Micrometer. Micrometer is also by Pivotal, like the Spring framework, and maybe that's the reason it gets pushed that hard by them. They are saying, think SLF4J, but for metrics. Who of you knows SLF4J? Yeah. So SLF4J is some kind of abstraction of logging frameworks, so you code against this API. And which logging framework gets used depends on what you have on the class path, basically. And Micrometer aims to do the same for the metric stack, so you can switch very easily from metrics framework to another framework. They have support for a lot of metric frameworks already yet, and they become more. And for sure they have support for Prometheus. So, for sure you can get the same stuff as I showed you before with Micrometer already yet, but it's a little bit too early in my opinion. We will not switch to Micrometer yet, because I'm not that happy with the documentation yet, to be honest. And also, the API is not that nice like the Prometheus API, in my opinion. Of course, they had to do, if you do a generalization of stuff, you have to make compromises, I think. If you want to use the stuff I showed you before, with Spring Boot 2, you simply have to register this bean, and you are fine. So everything works again. Visualization, in the end, you want to have dashboards, for sure. It's happening here. You can do this via the Prometheus expression browser, which is built in Prometheus. And it's really a nice tool to try out queries, and you have also some kind of visualization in there. Most of the people do it via Grafana. It has native support for Prometheus, and it works like a charm. And if you're more experienced, you can also use console templates. So you have to write your templates with Go templating language. To be honest, I have no experience with that. And yes, you can write your own UI if you want to, because Prometheus also has a RESTful API. Yeah, and you know these images and these dashboards. Last point for my talk, alerting. It happens here, yeah, it's a separate application. And the things I've told you about the configuration is also true for the alert manager, which means you don't have to restart the alert manager each time you make a configuration change. There's support for a lot of different ways to communicate your alerts. As already mentioned, alert manager is a separate application, so it has to be configured separately. And the Prometheus part of alerting, the Prometheus configuration part about alerting, is about what is an alert. The alert manager configuration part is how to get to whom this information gets sent. So in the Prometheus configuration, we are saying, for example, this is a Prometheus query, a PromQL expression. If the memory goes smaller than 8 gigs on this machine, wait for 30 seconds because maybe it's only a hiccup. We can add labels if you want. And then we define the text which in the end gets sent out via SMS or via mail or whatever. And you can also use label values for creating these texts. This is the alert manager configuration. I will skip the SMTP settings because they are boring. You have to define who will get the alert. In this case, is some group which is called Des, and only one guy is in there, which is called Steve. He will get it by email. You group it. In this case, we were talking about memory, so the previous configuration was about memory, so this gets grouped by the memory in this case. If the first alert of the group memory comes in, we wait for 30 seconds because maybe another alert comes in with the same root cause, and in the end, we do not want to have 27 emails, we only want to have one email. So we wait for 30 seconds for the next alert, for other alerts of the same group. Now it gets complicated. There's a second configuration possibility. If the first alert of this group was sent out, we again wait for 1 minute. If another alert, which was not sent out for this group yet, will come in. Yeah, and if the problem isn't solved after 1 hour, we want to get the alert again. You can go further with Prometheus. You can predict the future. Usually, you have data like this. Your data simply ends somewhere because you don't know the future normally. But you can do linear regression. So you can predict the value where it will be depending on your previous data. And you can create boundaries. And this is the Prometheus configuration, which does this linear regression. Here we are saying, given the data of the last 7 days about the disk space, calculate where this value will be in 7 days. And if this value in 7 days is below zero, alert me now. That's it. I think we still have time for questions, if there are any. Yes, please. Pardon, could you speak? I didn't get it, sorry. I'm not sure about this, but I think you can do this because Elastic doesn't have support for Prometheus. If you want to have information about Prometheus metrics about your Elastic database, you will not get it. I think this is. They want it like this. They don't want to have Prometheus in that easy that you can use it in Prometheus, their metrics, because Elastic has their own stack. Other questions? Okay, fine. Then thank you again.